So my starting point is a question that's about a feature of the 1820s revolution that really struck me. No? What did Navarra, the Basque countries, the city of Genoa, on the coastal city of Genoa in the kingdom of Sardinia, the Peloponnese, the islands of Samos, tell us about the revolutions of the 1820s? So my paper will seek to respond to this question by exploring the impact that the introduction of the constitutions had on the territorial organization of the states in this period. And the starting point of my paper is the fact that these revolutions, the 1820s revolutions, belong to a broader, a longer-term Ibero-American and Euro-Asian crisis in which sovereignty, that is to say the relationship between the boundaries of political communities and the rights and obligations of citizens, were questioned, rethought, and reconstituted. This crisis, precipitated by the Napoleonic Wars, gave rise, in the words of an eminent sort of historian of the Ibero-American world, Jeremy Edelman, to the simultaneous advent of, and I quote, patriotic localisms and centralism. These are the byproduct of this crisis of sovereignty that is not just Mediterranean, but global. So this is the background to my paper, and what I argue is that these revolutions share three converging features in relationship to the ways in which territories are rethought and reorganized. They, almost all of them, start with a federal moment, a centripetal moment that marks the beginning of the revolution. And this federal tendency is resisted, but a compromise tends to be found everywhere in all of these revolutions between supporters of federalism and supporters of centralism. What is achieved is a compromise that tends to sort of combine the acceptance of central controls, but also a degree of local self-government, which is what is approved in parliaments during the revolutions pretty much everywhere. At the same time, there is a degree of territorial resistance to the abolition of privileges that we can detect pretty much everywhere. And that's where the reference to these territories that I mentioned at the beginning of my paper comes from. And therefore, this frame of analysis, I think, has the benefit of enabling me to study together revolution, counter-revolution, and civil wars. They can all be analyzed under this general umbrella of territorial crisis. And the most acute territorial crisis are civil wars across Southern Europe and across the Mediterranean. So these are, I think, the main points of my paper. Federalism, centripetal tendencies, constitutional compromise, territorial resistance. The background is a background of two decades that, in my view, in different ways, saw a push towards centralization pretty much across this region. In some territories or states, this centralizing sort of tendency was stronger and was permanent. In others, was temporary. But we see a tendency, and we can talk about it more extensively later. And in partly, these revolutions are a reaction against what had happened in the previous two decades. In Spain, in Naples, and in Piedmont, it is, of course, the Cadiz Constitution sets the tone of the debates about the territorial reorganization of these states. A constitution that had introduced, let's remind ourselves, a uniform administrative system centered on the figure of the jefe político, but also on the introduction of other intermediary bodies, the deputaciones provinciales, that in the mind of the those who drafted the constitution were purely administrative bodies and not provincial representations. So this is an important element that puts together these revolutions and is a reference for all the debates in these countries. Another very important sort of historical institutional experience across the Mediterranean is, of course, 1808 and the creation of the juntas that act in the name of the missing sovereign in the face of the Napoleonic invasion. This memory and this model of juntas or committees reemerge across the Mediterranean powerfully in 1820 everywhere. So this is a very, very important experience that comes up again pretty much everywhere from Portugal to Greece. And it is, of course, the case of the revolution in Spain in 1820, triggered by the Riego's pronunciamento. You see juntas being created across the whole of the territories of Spain, in all the cities, in which sort of juntas are set up in the name of the nation as temporary bodies, although in some specific cases, for instance, in La Coruña, there is also an attempt to sort of recreate the federal dynamic that had existed in Spain in the face of the Napoleonic invasion. At La Coruña, they're hoping to create in 1820 another central junta with representatives from all the cities of Spain. So this federal tendency reemerges also in Spain at the end of 1821 when you have protest in cities like Valencia, La Coruña, and Murcia, and others against the government of the Moderados. And the cities of Spain take the initiative and say, we are the representative of the sovereign people. We do not recognize the authority of the government. So power goes back to the localities as well in this moment. So there is this federal tendency, and another conflict that demonstrates a sort of revanche of the locality is the conflict that throughout the triennio plays out between the jefes políticos and the councils, the local communities, when the jefes políticos intervene to question the results of local elections, but also the disputes about the powers of the deputaciones provinciales that are very often interpreted not as purely administrative bodies taking orders from the center, but as real representations of provinces. Let me just give you an example of a liberal newspaper that in the Basque country says that the diputaciones constitute a veritable bulwark against the usurpation of the executive, next to whose principal agent and under whose immediate presidency they have to act as a constant barrier in favor of popular interest. However, the most dramatic reactions to the introduction of the constitution in Spain are, of course, the counter-revolution coming from the Basque countries and Navarra, in which there is an important territorial dimension. The counter-revolution is also triggered by a defense, a wish to defend the fueros in these regions that traditionally enjoyed autonomy and privileges. What I want to highlight here is the existence of a variety of political and intellectual options in which liberal fuerismo is also an option that is conceived. And I think it's important, and I hope to demonstrate why it is important when I move to other revolutions, because these revolutions are interesting, in my view, because they also produce this sort of hybrid constitutional culture that wants to combine traditional notions and defense of local privileges and the modernity of new constitutions. This is not just a feature of Spain, but we can find it in the other countries in revolution, not just in Spain. In the end, I think by the end of the triennio, when the exaltados are in control of the cortes, this federal tendency wins. There is a revision of the powers of the deputaciones provinciales to take into account this desire for more provincial autonomy, but there's also a firm condemnation of the privileges demanded by the Basque countries and Navarra. I highlight this, which is sort of obvious sort of information for historians of Spain, because it shows there will be parallels in the other countries of these dynamics. If we move, in fact, from Spain to Piedmont, where there is a very short revolution, we find a similar movimiento juntero, the creation of juntas in the cities of Piedmont in the name of the nation, to the extent that the Piedmontese revolutionary press talks about the energy, the revolutionary energy coming from the provinces during the revolution. And also, as we found in Spain, there is a disintegrating tendency that, in the case of the Kingdom of Sardinia, comes from Genoa and Liguria. Why? Because Genoa had been an independent, oligarchic, aristocratic republic that had lost its independence in 1797 permanently, having been later annexed by to the French Empire. In 1814, with the end of the Napoleonic War, the aristocracy of Genoa had tried to reobtain its autonomy, had pledged, you know, to the Congress of Vienna the recreation of a republic or the creation of an autonomous monarchy annexed to the Piedmontese one, and this option had failed, leaving the aristocrats bitterly disappointed. They had hoped for the support of Britain in their quest for autonomy. Now, if you look at what happens in Genoa in 1821, you see that the students in the streets of Genoa were shouting together, "Viva la Costituzione, viva la Repubblica di Genoa," while the leader of the aristocratic faction of Genoa, Girolamo Serra, was negotiating with the British, hoping to regain the autonomy of the ancient republic. So here you have what I call a hybrid option, again, of the students who think about the Republic of Genoa, but also think about the Constitution of Cadiz, and the aristocrats who are nostalgic of the old oligarchic order. Again, parallels with this variety of options that emerge in the revolutions as they did in Naples. But the most dramatic decentralizing and federalist tendencies of these revolutions can be detected in the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies, where the 1820 revolution is marked by an efflorescence of juntas that are dominated by the secret society, by the Carboneria, that actually declare the revolution in the name of provincial freedom, everywhere, in Salerno, in Potenza, in Foggia. Why such a strong disintegrating or federalizing tendency in Naples? Because unlike Spain or Piedmont, the centralizing reforms of Napoleon had been kept by the Bourbons after 1815. The model of the intendenze had not been abolished. Not only had it not been abolished by the Bourbons, but it had been extended to Sicily. Sicily had been traditionally an autonomous kingdom. During the Napoleonic Wars, this identity that was political had been reinforced because the king had moved to Palermo and because the British had introduced a new constitution, according to the British model. So from 1817 onwards, Sicily becomes just a map of intendenze under a different name that have, and so the island loses completely the autonomy. Before going back to Sicily, I just want to highlight the fact that the Carbonari in Naples have a similar understanding of the Cadiz Constitution as the Exaltados in Spain. They see it as a federal document. They consider the Deputaciones Provinciales and the communes as sort of institutions that, and I quote from a political catechism from Naples, share equally sovereignty. Deputaciones provinciales and communes share equally sovereignty, they say. This federal understanding of the Constitution is rejected by the Muratists, the heirs of the Napoleonic experience that are dominating the government during the revolution in Naples. In fact, there is a debate in the parliament, and in the end, this understanding of quasi-federal understanding of the constitution is approved by the parliament that introduces the deputaciones provinciales, although it is then blocked by the government. But the most violent reaction against centralization come from Sicily. Sicily, again, sort of lends itself to a comparison with Liguria and with the Basque countries and Navarra, because Palermo, as an ancient capital that had lost its status, rebels against Naples and demands independence, declares the independence of the island. But significantly, the eastern part of the island, Catania, who was happy to have lost a dominant capital, sides with Naples. So this is a territorial crisis that has various dimensions. It's a crisis between Sicily and Naples, but it's also a crisis within Sicily that there is a civil war that has a profoundly important territorial dimension. Competition between regions, competition between provinces, competition between cities. Again, the solutions to this crisis are plural. There's not just one. There are many different solutions. Some are, let me just use this expression for the sake of convenience, hybrid. The more radical side of the Sicilian Patriotic Party wants a federal kingdom with a cortes, with a parliament in Palermo under the Cadiz constitution. So they want to federalize the kingdom of the two Sicilies. Others aristocrats are hostile and they want to retain more of the ancient privileges. They want to reintroduce the 1812 Sicilian constitution rather than the Cadiz one that was considered too democratic because it was aristocratic. In the end, in fact, the Neapolitan parliament rejects the project of a federalization of the state. The majority of the Neapolitan revolutionaries are federalists, but they don't want any special privilege for any territory. Again, like the Exaltados in Spain, they want a unitary administrative and regulatory and legislative framework for all their territories. They don't want Sicily to have any type of privilege. I want now to move very briefly to Portugal because I think that unlike the rest of Southern Europe, and then I'll move to Greece before concluding, in the 1820s, the revolution in Portugal, the Triennio and then the following Biennio, did not lead to a radical rethinking of the territorial reorganization of the state. So when I was comparing these countries, I had to ask myself, why is it that Portugal doesn't really fit exactly into this model? So the hypothesis is that perhaps there was no permanent Napoleonic legacy as there had been in Naples. Through the brief occupation of the French army, the Napoleonic model of administrative organization had been introduced, but this had been a temporary experience that had not left a permanent legacy, when the French left. There were no also intermediary provincial institutions in Portugal, to be defended or revised. There were no great territorial privileges to protect or abolish, with the exception of the existence of a number of feudal families that had the right to appoint the corregidores. Nonetheless, I think that that also the revolution in Portugal converges with the other revolutions on the fact, on the issue of communal freedom and communal autonomy, because also in Portugal, sort of communal autonomy is reinforced by the Constitution of 1822 by introducing sort of elected cameras and also the locally elected president of the camera. And this reinforces the autonomy of the commune. So in this sense, this element shows to me that there is a convergence with these other revolutions also in Portugal, although Portugal is a bit different from the others. And in fact, the most radical and most extreme case of a territorial crisis in this revolution is represented by the Greek War of Independence and the Greek Revolution, because it is a rebellion against an imperial authority. And it also leads to the creation of a new state. In this sense, it's really something quite special. Nonetheless, I want to talk about differences but also similarities with the other revolutions, because I think that also the Greek case displays a number of interesting converging features with the others. What are these converging features? The first one is that also in the Greek Revolution, as it had been, it was the case in Naples, in Spain, in Sicily, in Piedmont, the beginning of the revolution is a revolt of the localities. And it is a centripetal movement. What we find in the territories of Rumeli or Peloponnese are not juntas, they're not called juntas. We found ephores, cagellaries, kinotikes, or whatever they were called, but they were local bodies, local committees, sometimes simply replicating the Ottoman local municipal authorities that are turned into revolutionary bodies acting in the name of that region, of that place. So this is really a federal moment of a rebellion of localities that act in the name of themselves first, or later on in the names of themselves and the region and Greece. At the same time. Second, although of course Cadiz is not an important constitution in the Greek Revolution, it plays no role, the elites of the revolution are equally, as they are in the other countries, divided between federalists and centralizers. The centralizers of the Greek Revolution are the leaders of the Greek diaspora, coming from the great Phanariot families of the Greek elite that had served the empire. Having served the empire, at the heart of the empire, representing the empire in the principalities, they had inherited this mentality, this centralizing vision of authority that we must not forget, that they came from this experience, even if they became the leader of the revolution. They wanted a centralized state also because they had been imperial civil servants. Another converging feature of the Greek Revolution is that if we take the 1827 with the third constitution and the first recognition of the existence of the Greek state as a point of reference with the other revolutions, we find that that constitution, the constitution of Trizina, of Troezen, has striking elements of convergence and parallels with these other sort of administrative reforms that are approved by the parliaments in Portugal, Spain, and Naples. The creation of a centralized administrative system based on the figure of the eparch. The eparch is like the jefe politico in Spain, or the intendente in Naples, or the prefect in Napoleonic France, but also the recognition of a degree of local autonomy. In fact, this constitution introduces elected municipalities, but also elected provincial committees at the level of the eparchy. The eparchy is the district unit, with elected representatives of the whole of the eparchy called demogerontes. Again, I find the parallel with the deputaciones provinciales, although the constitution doesn't exactly spell out what are the relationships between this committee and the eparchy. It's left in a very fluid way. So in this sense, I see striking convergences between the Greek Revolution and these other revolutions. Of course, the path is extraordinarily complicated because it's the path towards the creation of a new state, which is quite an extraordinary historical event in general, punctuated by conflicts and also by civil wars. But the civil wars are not uniquely Greek instances, as we have seen by looking at the other revolutions. So these civil wars are territorial conflicts, quite clearly, especially the second civil war between the end of 1824 and 25 is a war that opposes the elites of the Peloponnese to the elites of Rumeli and the elites of the islands. It has a strong territorial dimension, and significantly it is triggered by the rejection in the Peloponnese of the recognition of an authority of the central government, like an eparch, and also the refusal to pay taxes. It's a rejection of the central authority. And significantly, these civil wars take place after the introduction of the first properly centralized constitution of Greece in 1823, the one of Argos, that abolishes what had existed in the previous 2 years, regional parliaments. From 1823, the elites of the revolution abolish regional parliaments to try and create a unitary state. Not surprisingly, in the following 2 years, you have civil wars. It's the difficulty of accommodating this effort to create a unitary state. What forces individuals to find a compromise, the elites of Hydra, the elites of the Peloponnese, of Roumeli, to work together and go beyond a regional vision of their freedom, is the war. It is the invasion of Ibrahim. It is the need to have a unitary front against the Ottomans that forces, that creates the state in Greece. Nonetheless, and this shows another element of convergence with the other revolutions, there are territories that refuse systematically to be absorbed within the new Greek state. A case is the case of the island of Samos. The islands of the Aegean had traditionally, for centuries, enjoyed a great degree of autonomy. They were basically self-governing territories, no? Loosely controlled by the head of the Ottoman fleet, but in reality autonomous. And the island of Samos, in particular, was a principality that was linked to a religious confraternity, a religious institution in Istanbul, always enjoying autonomy. In the 1820s, a local leader within an internal civil war rises, called Logothenis, becomes the leader of Samos, creates. Again, forgive me for this expression, a hybrid constitution that uses the local Ottoman committees to create a constitution that is elected and refuses to accept the authority of the Greek central government, saying that the eparchs, the Greek prefects, are tyrants. Tyrants, tyranny. These are the words that the exaltados also in Spain or people in Naples use to condemn representatives of the central government. So I want now to come to my conclusion, briefly, to suggest that if there is a shared feature in this revolution, is the determination by the majority of the supporters of the constitutional order to introduce administrative and territorial uniformity, but at the same time to take into account demands coming from the localities, demands coming from the peripheries, for a degree of self-government. Yet, in some territories, these sort of offers to take into account these desires for autonomy were not deemed sufficient, and hence civil war and rebellion and defense of ancient privileges, with also the coming up of these hybrid solutions that I find, when studying the constitutions in this period, the most interesting and the least studied constitutional options. These, in fact, revolutions represent only one page of a longer narrative of crisis of sovereignty in this period, as the following ones will play out in different directions. If we look at what happens in these territories after these revolutions, we see that these crises play out in different and interesting directions. So these tendencies that are at the same time of centralization and patriotic localisms, as Edelman calls them, continue after the 1820. They continue in Spain with the Carlist War, showing that also the absolutist government are against the fueros, and therefore there is a Carlist War because the fueros are not really appreciated by absolutism. It comes up again in Sicily, where in 1837 there is a revolution, and in this case, a novelty is that Catania no longer sides with Naples. Catania is now against Naples, so there is a new dimension to the territorial crisis of the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies. In Liguria, we will no longer find this tendencies, they kind of disappear. I'm not sure why. I don't have an explanation for that. And I want to conclude on this, Samos, in fact, will go back into the fold of the Ottoman Empire and under Ottoman sovereignty in 1832, however, as an autonomous principality, ironically under a Christian prince, a member of the Phanariot elite that had taken the leadership in the Greek Revolution, but some had remained loyal to the Ottoman Empire. So in the end, the elites of Samos are quite happy with this solution that guarantees their traditional autonomy. So this is also one of the possible outcomes of the crisis of sovereignty of the 1820s, going back to empire. Thank you.